Hello and welcome to Walk the Talk. I am Shekhar Gupta and my guest today, General Zameer Uddin Shah, one of the most illustrious officers in the Indian Army.
Thank you.
Better dressed than most people, better dressed than me, which is easy, but better dressed than most people. And sir, somebody who in his memoir has called himself the Sarkari Mussalman.
Well, I am not a Sarkari Mussalman, but I have named my memoir the Sarkari Mussalman because it is a sobriquet or a title given by the Muslim community to people who generally government servants when they don't cater to illegitimate demands of the community.
Or stereotypes.
Or stereotype. That is one type.
Right.
My father was called one when he tried to implement reforms in the Dargah in Ajmer. I had the fortune of meeting some young boys when I was a second lieutenant. And I tried to convince them to opt for the armed forces as a career.
Muslim boys?
Muslim boys from the Aligarh Muslim University Riding Club.
Right.
And they had come to IMA to participate. And I told them the honor and glory of wearing a uniform. I also told them that we need horsemen. And then at the end of the talk, I said, how many of you want to opt? Not a single person. For the army. Not a single person opted. They said in unison, Janab, aap to Sarkari Musalman hai. It meant that I was a government stooge trying to push a government agenda. So that stuck to me.
Right.
And I said, if I ever write a book, I'll call it the Sarkari Musalman, but I am not one.
Yeah. But have times changed since then? Have young Muslims given up their suspicion of Sarkar or working for the government or working for an institution like the army? Or does a lot of it still continue?
No, I think there's been a quantum improvement. When I joined the NDA, I was a lone Muslim in my course of 200 cadets. I'm told in one of the batches, there were 10 Muslim cadets, which is a very good positive sign.
Right.
Muslims, this is our country, and they too owe a responsibility for the defense of their country. So I think it's a healthy sign.
Lieutenant General Atta Hasnain has written for us, in fact, starting this debate, that more and more Muslims should look at the army as a career.
I agree with
especially
him.
Especially as officers.
Absolutely.
Did you feel a sense of discrimination or did you feel, were you a trophy if you were the only Muslim in your batch?
No, nobody knew I was a Muslim.
Uh-huh.
In the National Defense Academy, you are given a nickname. Mine was carried by my schoolmates, Zoom Shah. Z-O-O-M Shah.
Right.
So nobody knew. In fact, people
that
are quite surprised.
Sounds very trendy even today.
Everybody. You know, the nickname was not linked to any religion, caste, creed or anything like that.
Right.
It was on some peculiar characteristic. For people who had protruding teeth, they were called dentist.
Right.
Or, you know, things like that.
Right.
So it was a name given to me. And let me tell you that I face no discrimination and I'm not being a hypocrite.
You said in the academy you never felt, at that point, which year was this, sir?
I joined the National Defense Academy in 1964.
64.
I was 15 and a half years old.
Right.
I tried to sprout a mustache to look older. And I didn't face any discrimination, I faced affirmative action.
Right.
One day, one of my course mates, in jest, call me Katwa. Yes.
Katwa is a pejorative for Muslims.
So the rest of the classmates got after him and says, don't ever say it again. So that's the sort of attitude which encouraged me.
Right.
And I was very enthused by this response.
And you got it from top officers also, seniors.
Absolutely.
Also.
I mean, they never made any distinction.
Was there ever any suspicion? Ki bhai isko mat batao?
Never. I mean, I was the operational officer in a division in Husainiwala, opposite Pakistan.
In 65?
Post 71.
Yes.
I was privy to all the defense. I was privy to everything. I was in the military secretaries branch.
So you knew all the postings?
I was deputy chief. I mean, I was privy to every national secret.
Right.
There was never a time when I was told, General Shah, you go and play golf.
Right. And why we plan something.
Or why, while we are discussing, you go and, you know, never of that.
And op parakram time, I believe you were commanding a strike division, which was poised to strike deep if need be.
That's right. I was
a key division.
I was a key division.
54.
54. And the very fact that my division was, since we are not committed on the ground, we are not a holding
division.
You
were not a defensive decision.
We were a strike division. I was tasked to lead the formation. I was told later by General Padmanabh,
who was the chief then?
Who was the chief. In my book, of course, I have not given his name. But when I did mention it, he said that there were misgivings. I never felt anything. The army, when asked, was told that we have not sent a Muslim general. We've sent the commander of the force,
right,
which is committed. And I thought that was a very good way of looking at it.
Yeah. So you mean misgivings in the sense that people raised questions that why did the army send a Muslim general?
Absolutely.
Right.
The misgivings about that.
Right. But the fact is that you just happen to be commanding a division that could be deployed there.
Absolutely. The army makes no distinction of religion, race or color or creed.
Right.
It is the commanding officer which is commanding the formation and committed who commands.
And you were in reserve.
So I was in the reserve, absolutely.
Whereas the division in Ahmedabad, based in Ahmedabad, was not available.
They were a holding formation. They were deployed holding the border.
In defensive position.
Absolutely.
So what happened when you came to Ahmedabad?
Well, I was given the warning order by the chief personally on the night, on the evening of 28th of February 2002. He just spoke to me for 2 minutes. He said, "Zoom, get your formation into Gujarat and curb the riots." I told him, "Sir, it'll take us 2 days."
And your formation was used to cavalry and mechanized forces?
Yes, we have elements of...
Yeah.
Well, it was the strike formation.
Yeah.
And
if I do remember correctly, in General Sundarji's times, it was earmarked to be an air assault formation.
That's right.
Right.
It's at various times, it was an amphibious division and
right,
other things. But it is a very potent division.
Fighting force.
It's a very potent fighting force, and I'm very, very proud to have commanded it.
Right. And then what happened
and
once
so
you landed?
And so I told him, so he said, "Don't worry. Get it to Jodhpur airfield. The Air Force is laying it on." They did. 60 flights. I mean, the complete resources of the Air Force was mobilized to move. I left immediately with my...
So 60 transport planes?
Well, 60 flights.
60 flights, yes.
Maybe less number of planes.
Yes,
but they were ferrying...
60
sorties. They were ferrying us the whole night.
Right.
They were ferrying us up and from
right,
from Jodhpur to Ahmedabad.
Right.
When we flew in, I saw the whole city aflame. The whole city was burning. There were fires burning everywhere. The airfield was deserted. It was dark. We landed and the deputy GOC of the holding formation met me. Brigadier Mehra.
That was 11th Div.
Of 11th Div, he had been sent down to receive me.
And brief you. Yes.
Yes. And I had been told that you will get all the resources you need.
Right.
The resources we required was transport.
Right.
Because we couldn't carry them. Maps.
Right.
Magistrates.
Yes, because this was not AFSPA. You were in aid to civil power, so you needed magistrates to open fire.
Yes, we needed that. Although a military officer, if he feels the situation, even if the magistrate is not there, he can fire, but he has to explain.
He has to explain.
He has to explain. So I asked Brigadier Mehra, "Where is the resources?" So he says, "The state government is providing it." So I said, "Give me the chief secretary." Oh, he said, "He's abroad." So I said, "Who's officiating?" So he gave me a number. I tried to call. There was no response from the officiating. It was a lady, the chief secretary. So I decided that the only way to get things done was to go to the chief minister. I asked for a guide and I reached the chief minister's office at 2 in the morning on the morning of 1st of March.
Hmm.
There to my...
2002.
There to my great relief was the Raksha Mantri, Mr. George Fernandez.
He was there.
He was there. Right. He was having late dinner with the chief minister.
Chief Minister, Mr. Modi.
Yes. So I had carried a tourist map, because we didn't have maps of Ahmedabad.
And there were no Google Maps those
days.
Not yet.
So
there was no Siri.
On a tourist map of Gujarat, we plotted the trouble spots. And I was told...
I think the maps you had memorized were somewhere in Multan sector.
Quite right. I mean,
right,
that was working in our mind.
Right.
You know, all these things. I had completely forgotten of... I had no inkling that
right,
we would be committed
yeah,
on this. And let me tell you, it's a task which is abhorred by the army.
Right.
We don't like get committed into
civil situation,
because they are our own nationals, they are
right,
our own citizens, and then one has to take action against them. So I was assured that they would come. So I went back, I received all the troops. There were large number. Six battalions were flown in It was
that means if I can take this question forward, and maybe I'm taking it too far. Did you get the sense that the central government had shown its keenness with moving a strike division in that crucial time when our parakram was on, in giving you 60 sorties of the Air Force to move you there, but then you hit a wall with the state government?
Well, no, that would be a political statement.
Right.
I think it was an administrative failure.
Right.
Basically because of the chief
secretary. Well, I didn't suggest, I'm not going so far as to say it was deliberate. But the fact is that
it was an administrative failure.
Yeah, nothing moved from there.
Nothing moved. The chief secretary who should have been there, or the officiating chief secretary, should have ensured that the wherewithal for us to move into the city and all over Gujarat should have been positioned. But it wasn't. On the morning of 2nd, Mr. George Fernandez visited us at the airfield. And
sir, what happened when you reached the Chief Minister's home at night?
Well,
at 2 a.m.
Well, he welcomed me.
Right.
He was very warm, and both showed great relief.
Right.
So I said, "Sab, troops aane wale hain. Abhi main first flight mein aaya. Luckily, I had taken my vehicle and communications, and so we shared the something to eat, and then I moved back with the assurance that things would be provided. They were ultimately provided on 2nd morning.
Right.
Mr. George Fernandez came to us at about 10 o'clock.
On the 2nd?
On the 2nd. On 2nd.
The 2nd. Or not on the 1st?
On 2nd morning.
So all of the 1st, you were just sitting?
We were just sitting there. That's right.
And George Fernandez was in Ahmedabad then?
Oh, did I say 2nd? I think.
He visited on 1st.
First morning
at 10 o'clock. And what did he say then?
Well, he said he addressed the whole troop. We got them all together. It was a Senik Sammelan.
Right.
And he says, you must ensure fair play.
Yes.
You must make sure that the message goes home that the army has been deployed. And whatever is your requirement, we'll make it up. So he left after that. The trailers, the transport started rolling in on the 2nd, and then we deployed.
Yeah. But so, if you had been deployed on the 1st itself, would have saved some lives?
Of course. It would have saved one day of rioting.
Rioting.
Certainly.
Right. And did you ask people, did you reflect on it as to what happened, why did it happen? Was it deliberate? Was it not deliberate?
Well, I did speak to a lot of people. There was a rift in even the police. I mean, I was getting different versions of what actually happened. I didn't take it. But I do know that made everybody angry was the bringing the bodies of the Karsevaks from Godhra to Ahmedabad.
Right.
That inflamed passions.
Right.
I think again it was an administrative failure, a decision which shouldn't have been done. If that had not been done, probably the people would not have been so inflamed. I mean, anybody would get inflamed.
Was it a mistake? Was it deliberate?
I will not say that. I will not comment. I would say it's a mistake.
Okay.
I would say it's a mistake, but you can draw your own inference.